about a very practical project, about typesetting something real which people can touch by hands, and you will have chance to touch it as well. Please take a chance to look at more than one, maybe. This project was done by, I did the typesetting for the company called Lingea, based in Czech Republic. And so first, maybe I tell you something about the background of the company to understand the project better. So the Lingea company, for many years already, it works in the natural language processing. It produces spell checkers, grammar checkers, electronic dictionaries, and it practically took the whole market in Czechia and Slovakia. So it supplies to major companies like Microsoft and others. So the strong point of the company is that they have a very efficient representation of data. So their application have very small footprint on even embedded machines, on mobile phones and things like that, and it's reasonably fast, so that's a competitive advantage of the company. Over time they built big multilingual databases with generic structure and markup. So the databases contain several kinds of data, like words translations, phrases translation, descriptions of items in the dictionaries, examples, collocations, idioms. They keep track of the frequencies of the words in the language. They have phonetic transcriptions, which they sometimes generate automatically, sometimes they produce them by experts. And they have records of audio made by native speakers. These data are constantly improving and growing. So they started in electronical publishing, but after some time they got the idea that it might be actually a good business to produce some hard copy books. So they also tried to produce some dictionaries, and they were quite successful. And it's important to notice that the dictionaries come from the same databases as the electronic publications. So it's not like doing books from scratch. They are reusing all the data for all the projects. They make like several variants of the same dictionary based on the frequency filtering. So they make smaller and bigger versions and so on. After the success of the dictionaries, they came with the idea that it might be a good opportunity to make something more fancy. So they came with the idea of the phrase books, and by coincidence I was around, so we started to discuss the requirements. So the requirements were quite specific. They wanted to use as much as possible of things they already had. So they had the databases, they had some conversion tools. The dictionaries before, they did it in Tech. Yeah? So they had some conversion tools from their proprietary database format to Tech. So there was already some markup borrowed from the dictionaries. So that was one part which was already there for some time. The other part was a fancy graphical design by a graphical designer. And when he used to cooperate with the company for longer time already, and there were always some technical compromises. Yeah, like when he wanted to do something fancy, they told me we can't do it because tech doesn't allow us to do that. And so this time they told him not to feel restricted. Next requirement was it wouldn't be just one book. So when we started, we had like five target languages. It was English, German, French, Russian, and Spanish. That was the traditional portfolio of the company, these languages. And the markets were in Czechia and Slovakia. That used to be one country before, right? But there were also branches open by that time in Poland and Romania. So we have already like 20 combinations of languages, right? The processing had to be repeatable and automatic because the data were changing, they were improving all the time. People were still working on it, so it was reprocessed and reprocessed after each change several times a day. There were in the databases, because the data were shared between, like, there will be an electronic version as well, so they kept the markup to the minimum and with practically very little instructions in data, like maybe new pages or something like that, but very little processing instructions. And the minimal human intervention was required because it was run several times a day by lexicographers, which didn't know anything about tech. They just wanted to see the output. So it looks like perfect decoupling between the data and the layout, between the content and the processing. So it was a good challenge. It's probably good to say something about my own background. So I re-implement tech in Java in the past, so therefore I should know the internals of tech very well, right, on one hand. But on the other hand, I never typesetted anything real in any real big book. So that was, in a way, a great opportunity to try my skills. So, I will show you the books and some samples. So, the book has structure, not very surprising. There is a list of content, introduction to language, the conversational guide, that's the main part. That's the major part of the book. Then there are dictionaries from the language and to the language, and this is actually something they already had. So there was actually a lot of legacy. Like I did I concentrated just on this main part. Sorry for the flickering. Because the other parts, they were already provided from the past, from the dictionaries they published before, which was in a way an advantage, because there was something they could look at very, very fast. But I had to work with the old stuff, which I didn't always like. So there was no complete freedom, like writing packages from scratch. So another important part is the grammar of the language and some information for the travelers. When you look at the hard copies which are circulating, you can see all of them. So maybe I show quickly. So this is the main part, actually. So the main part consists of four subsections with different colors. There are pictures in there. There are four main pictures for four main parts, and then there are like headings with pictures. There are two main kinds of information. These are phrases, so some sentences and their translations, and in blue there is a phonetic transcription. Then there are so-called collocations or words, if you like. So this gives the basic vocabulary. Several kinds of headings with some nice design. So what's next? Interesting. There were so-called info boxes, which provide some additional interesting information, part of the graphical design. There can be, there are some sub-items here. There can be more boxes if they fit in. So this is the conversational part. So as I said, there are these sections, headings, and so on. I've shown already all of them. Now, the challenges involved. Because, well, it doesn't look very much like typeset by tech, right? the book. There were many challenges which I won't talk about, like using the old styles which I had to adjust to the new needs and so on. But there were some, there were a few interesting puzzles in there. Like for example, balancing the boxes. I'll show you quickly. I forgot my notes. Never mind. In each item there are two boxes, left-hand box and the right-hand box, right? And in some cases they are not very balanced. Let me see. Just a second, please. So in some cases, if there is just one line, like here, you see the cursor. If there is just one line like here. Yeah, there is one line on the left-hand side, one line on the right-hand side, and it fits together. Yeah? And there are cases like here, for example, these two. The line on the right-hand side would fit in one line, yeah, the content on the right-hand side. But it wouldn't look so nice because there is already two lines here. So why not to use two lines here to make a better separation of the two parts. So that was one of the first tricks I was playing with, for example. This was actually a small trick, but there were other problems, like you see that the content is really dense. Yeah, there is not much space left. Yeah, there was like the original graphical design was much more generous with spaces, but then my boss fought with the graphical designer to squeeze as much content as possible. So for some reason he saw that people in the shop and they open the book, and if they see that it's full of content, they are more willing to buy it probably. So the requirement was to squeeze as much as possible. So in this case, these are boxes. Yeah, this left-hand side, the right-hand side, but this dotted separator, which is itself a PDF literal, must use no extra space, no waste of space. So it's always related to the last baseline in the box. So in the processing, I have to remember, well, how many lines are in each box. I have to export outside the box. That's one thing because of the balancing. The other is what's the most bottom baseline in both boxes. Yeah, and then it all, so it's sort of typeset on a grid with exact placing of this dotted separator. Then another little challenge was, here is the end, that it ends with a dotted separator, right? And it starts here with another one. So that's something I had to use marks and output routine for. I don't remember the details.
When there are descenders,
Yeah, well, it doesn't depend on these descenders. It depends always on the baseline. It doesn't matter. Like it's measured. It's measured. Yeah. At first, I measure how big are typical letters in the font. But if there is something bigger, it goes over the separator because it's so rare that it doesn't pay off to. Yeah, it's better to allow few mistakes than breaking up the grid. Okay, so this was about the lines on the grid. Okay, next nice puzzle was these info boxes. Yeah, so there are info boxes which are in line, but in the data it says like it should be exactly on this place. But mostly they are collected on the end of the chapter. Here there are two of them. The policy with these info boxes was that they are not that important. Yeah, the data, the phrase is very important, and this was something just to fill in the space on the end of the chapter. So I couldn't use floats for that, or I wouldn't. And so these are collected, and then they are placed on the end of the chapter only if they fit in, and only those which fit in. Yeah? And so for the debugging, I provided a feature. This is not a production version, this is a debugging version. So on the end of this PDF there are boxes which didn't fit with the indication how much they didn't fit. So this involved some tracking of the page goal and things like that. Next topic was the management of the images. There was more not fitting. So these images, they have round corners here. That's another PDF literal. They didn't want to, of course, they didn't want to specify the names of the files in the data. Yeah, so there is another level of abstraction. There are some identifiers, and they are even modified by languages because there are some there is some basic layer of identifiers, and then it can change for different languages. The content is not always the same for all languages. There are some conditional includes. So for example, they decided not to put the chapter about the ice hockey in Vietnamese or skiing in Arabic. So for these pictures, I had to provide a database-like support of some maps, which the key value pairs of identifiers and locations in PDF files, which were supplied by the graphical designer. So the map looked like identifier, name of the file, and number of the page, and it was fetched from external files to place here, dependent on the language. Because when we started to produce Asian languages, we found it was a shame to show only white faces on all pictures. So we had to make an alternative database with some Asian faces. Another thing worth mentioning is this phonetic transcription. This is a mixture of a normal Latin alphabet and IPA alphabet. Because for the normal dictionaries, the big dictionaries, the company uses IPA alphabet, but for such kind of book, it was considered to be too difficult for people. So they went by providing something close to what people can understand. So it uses mainly the normal letters and few IPA letters in cases where it's really necessary to distinguish. And this is even language dependent, so it changes. Like for Polish and Slovak, even Slovak speakers, it's slightly different, and it's all done automatically. So at the beginning we made those five languages, and then there was, because it was sort of a success, it started to sell well, they started to think about the next issue of books and new more languages. And in the first edition there was an old grammar taken from the old dictionaries, which looked very plain, very one color, nothing special. So they decided to use a new design for grammar. I'll show you shortly. So this is where, so this is the point where I developed the record and table packages, which I was talking yesterday about. Here's the German grammar. Yeah, so you can see it has a rich structure of the content with many sorts of headings and graphical elements. It's much more structured than the basic phrase apart. And it has tables, and these tables you can see that they align vertically. I have these lines here. So even now, like this left-hand column is the same width, but this divides to four parts, here three parts, for example. So it was the intention was that sometimes it's wider. We had many kinds of these table prototypes, but the idea behind was that if the vertical lines are close to each other, then they should line up. It would be a big shame if, like, this line was just few points left or right. Right, so that was the idea behind the very abstract specification of the tables, which I was showing some samples yesterday in the code. Yeah, or here we see the example of 4 columns and 5 columns here. So if everybody's interested, I can show more of the code, but I think it's enough for the moment. Yeah?
You showed a grammar, right?
Yeah?
How difficult is it to learn also the roadmap table to the upper one so that the number of vertical lines is minimized? I mean, pushing the
which one? Here?
The bottom.
Yeah.
To the right, so that the column aligns with the upper.
Yeah, well, I mean that wouldn't look nice because there are two columns of the same. Yeah, I mean if not a problem, it doesn't look like a mistake. Yeah? If one line is here, one line is here. That's okay. Yeah, like if they were off just by few points, that would look like a mistake. This is clear intention, right? Yeah, I think so.
Technically, wouldn't be a problem.
No, of course not. Technically, it wouldn't be. Okay, next slide. Okay, here is where the LuaTeX goes into the picture. So later we decided to support Asian languages with non-Latin scripts, right? So we needed some Unicode-aware tech engine, so we have chosen LuaTeX. One of the reasons was that Hans Haken is my friend, so he could support me on Skype with all the difficult questions. I had to provide some minimal LaTeX support internally. So I don't know if those things are already around or not, but it was like I couldn't spend much time on searching. At a certain point, I decided to provide my own UniEnt dev file for the symbols and stuff like that. Which is like compatible with the OT, 2, and dev, and so on. I had to incorporate many Unicode OTF fonts, and I had to provide Uni encoding file font descriptors for them. Okay, so that was one part, accessing of the fonts and symbols. And it was okay for most, for the languages with left to right typesetting. And then one of the biggest challenges was the mixed direction typesetting with Hebrew and Arabic. So I should show some examples. So this is Arabic, here we go. Yeah, so you see the design is slightly different because even in the headings. This looks quite funny because here it comes from the left, here it comes from the right. Yeah, this sort of heading had to be adjusted too. Yeah, this maybe the biggest challenge was the phonetic transcription because it had to fit into the same box somehow. So here it comes quite naturally on one line from right-hand side and left-hand side. And it possibly meets in the middle. And this is for the, but if it fits on two lines, then the first line goes from the right, the second goes from the left. And I'll show you some... I made a note on a paper. I noted the pages, but I left the paper on my on the desk over there. So okay, so here, for example, but that's not what I'm looking for. Yeah, here. So we wanted to squeeze. Yeah, it would be a pity to place this on four lines, right? So for this trick, I actually had to write a Lua text script and post-process the box, because it's not possible to do it with tech primitives. The box is typeset, some marks are put inside, and then there is a Lua script which goes through the box and changes the direction of the text at the right spot. So the first paragraph is flush to the right, with the end is short, right? And the second part, it's flush to the left, and the beginning is short. So effectively, this is there is like no Parfilsky, is on the right end. So the Parfilsky goes here in the middle. So this is what you can do with LuaTeX. And then it's worth mentioning that there was a lot of work with the language configuration, and that the Babel is not really good for such kind of a project, because not even for the Asian languages which are not defined at all, but even for other languages, it doesn't provide uniform interface, and that was what we really needed. There is no way how to say, like, I need to make quotation marks in the proper quotation marks in the given language, because each language does it differently. So we needed a unified interface, which I started to built on top of Babel, but if I had the chance to do it again, I would go for a package from scratch, completely avoiding Babel for this. Yeah, okay, I'm going to finish. So, why tech was relevant for this project? I mean, because that was automatic batch processing. The content was constantly evolving. It's not like you give a ready text content to the typesetter and wait 1 month to do the job. There was a legacy because they already used tech. Because actually, maybe not all people know, but Adobe InDesign has also some batch processing capabilities, because it can export and import XML. So it's actually, for some projects, it might be actually a better option to use InDesign, because it does a decent job, and it supports imports and exports. Then the knowledge base, because I know tech, I don't know InDesign, so if you want to do a job and you have people who know some tool, it's better to leave the decision for them, to let them choose what they prefer. And I think it wouldn't be possible to play with so many details in design, because we have much, because the tech is much more open than any other tool around. Last slide. And because it's sort of a habit to comment on why is tech more relevant now than ever. So I think it's more relevant because we have no more database publishing, right? Like this, it's more, well, it has been around all the time, but now it's maybe more prominent that the data are kept in databases and needed to be processed quickly, maybe for the web publishing, yeah, maybe you want to produce fresh document from updated data on the web. But I think the main challenge are the electronic documents, because there are two aspects. One is the resolution is improving. Yeah, at the beginning of the web, the HTML was okay because the resolution is poor anyway. So, I mean, HTML, rendering HTML is not a good typography, but it's totally adequate for the resolutions of the screen we had those times. But now the resolutions of the screens are improving, so it comes naturally to demand typographic quality for them. The other is, it's like we don't have to follow the old patterns, yeah, because we have interaction. So why not to demand some flexibility of the document? Yeah, like on the paper, we can't change the font or the width of the columns or number of the columns, even whatever. But I mean, static PDF is not good enough for dynamic electronic media, right? So, I mean, these are the challenges, and so I can imagine document format with some sort of design that leaves some options to the user, not all of them maybe, because then there would be no design at all, but maybe provide some fixed design and some options to the user so he can choose, yeah, in some limits. Yeah. And, well, unfortunately, tech is, I think, not up to this task yet, yeah, but it's the best tool we have at the moment. And it's a good start. So, thank you for your attention. Any questions? Is there time for questions?
Yeah, we will have a great break. You could have told me those yesterday, and I would have made a fool of myself. You used my title to improve your own. Thank you very much. Any questions?
The packages. Okay, I used two packages for doing those. Unfortunately, when I talked to my boss that time, I told him, like, you know, this is generic. This has nothing to do with these publications. Yeah? It's a pretty generic stuff. Let's publish it for free. Yeah? Let's make it free. And he is sort of difficult guy. He gave it a short thought, and he said, no. You did it in your paid time. Yeah. And later he started to think, like, okay, maybe it would be a good advertisement. So maybe on behalf of our company, it can go parts of it somewhere. But I mean, it's much easier if I now do a new version with just nothing to do with the previous one. You just need to wait a bit more, and I think I can provide better version for free.
Last question, bro.
Could you automatically do the reverse with the same data instead of check to English and English to check?
It's not like fully automatic, yeah, because there are. Yeah, well, it's not much work, actually. Yeah, like, for certain languages, I don't even see what they do. Yeah, I provided the framework. So at the moment, there is 31 languages from Czech language. Yeah, there are, like, 31 different language mutation for Czech. Most of them is available for Slovak. Some of them are available for Polish and Romanian. And then there is one circling around is Czech for English. Yeah, so this is the reverse. Of course, it's not fully automatic, but it's quick. It's a quick process. And then we had a licensee in Netherlands, so we have a few books from Dutch to other languages. The content provided, the company provided the content, the licensee provided just the cover, which is different, but otherwise the content is the same for other language. And so if you want to license, it's possible that the company is looking for licenses to reuse the work. And if you would like to provide data for some other language, it also can be negotiated. Yeah, like maybe with some, there was, for example, Vietnamese, which was, there were probably even some grants from some ministry to, because there is a big community in our country, so there can be support. So even for a language which is not generating profit, it could be still interesting if somebody provides the data to do even a small book, maybe not a full version, but it's possible to negotiate that.
Thank you very much, Karol.
Welcome.